Hello and welcome to this lesson. I'm now going to talk about using the IPv6 protocol in an Amazon VPC. So remember I mentioned earlier in the course that there's two versions of IP which are used extensively. One of them is IPv4. That's by far the most commonly used. It's been around for quite a long time. And then there's IPv6. Now, IPv6 has also been around quite a few years, but it's not been used anywhere near as extensively. But that needs to change over time because we are running short of IPv4 addresses. So we're going to have a look at how you can use IPv6 in a VPC. So let's start by looking at the structure of the IPv4 address. So you remember, it's made up of four numbers separated by dots. And those numbers come from an octet, so that's 8 binary bits, which are either 1 or 0. So an IPv4 address is 32 bits long. Now, let's have a look at how many addresses you get for that. You get 4.3 billion addresses, which sounds like a big number. And it's a big number if it's dollars in your bank account. But when it's addresses that need to be assigned to all sorts of different devices all over the world, in a world full of 7 billion people, it's just not anywhere near enough. And it might have sounded like more than enough quite a few years ago, but it became apparent even in the 90s that it was not going to suffice, and it hasn't. So we are close to exhausting these addresses, and NAT has to be used extensively. So if you're in a company and your company has thousands of computers internally, then those computers will most likely be using IPv4 addresses, and those will be private addresses. And when they access the internet, they go through a NAT device of some sort. And that means that a public IP address is used to represent many, many PCs. So that's a workaround that we have to put in place with IPv4. With IPv6, we don't have to worry about that. So let's look at the structure of an IPv6 address. So this is the structure of IPv6. It also has a network part and a node part, but it's 128 bits long, so it's a much, much bigger number. But also, it uses hexadecimal, whereas IPv4 uses dotted decimal. So that means there's a lot more potential values that you can use in hexadecimal versus decimal. So that means the amount of addresses is much, much bigger. And this is the number. That's the number of addresses you can get out of IPv6, and it's absolutely huge. To put it into some kind of perspective, and by the way, if you look on Google for analogies for the size of the IPv6 address space, there's all sorts of fantastic analogies because it really is massive. So one that I like is that you can get 100 IPv6 addresses for every atom on Earth. So that is a huge, huge number, which means we never ever have to worry about running out of IPv6 addresses. So let's have a look at how we need to set up our VPC. So we've got a VPC with a couple of subnets. We need to have an IPv4 CIDR block, and then we need the individual subnet ranges for our subnets. Now, we also need an IPv6 CIDR block now, so we've allocated one to this account. Now, AWS will assign a /56 IPv6 address range to the VPC. Then you can create your subnet ranges within that address space, and those become /64 subnets. Now, a /64 subnet will allow 18 million trillion addresses. So again, it's an example of why you really don't need to worry about how many addresses you're going to have for your computers, because it's just huge. Now, you'll notice there's two numbers highlighted in red at the end of the IP address here. This is a hexadecimal pair, which has values from 00 to FF. And this designates the individual subnet. So it has to be unique for each subnet, and it means that you're going to have a possible 256 subnets with IPv6 blocks in them, and each of those is a /64, so each of those will support 18 million trillion addresses. So lots of flexibility for your VPC. Now let's look at the route table once we've enabled IPv6. So we now have a local route for the IPv6 CIDR block. And we need a route to the internet gateway for everything that's outside of that range. Just like we did for IPv4, we have the ::// 0 for IPv6, pointing at the internet gateway's ID. And that means that anything that's not an IPv6 address in this range will go to the internet gateway. So we'll make sure that we have that specified in our route table when we enable IPv6. Now, all IPv6 addresses are publicly routable. That means there's no network address translation. Now, if you want to, you can use something called an egress-only internet gateway. Now, the purpose of this is when you want to allow outbound access only using IPv6. So it's kind of like having a EC2 instance in a private subnet with IPv4 and then adding a NAT gateway into a public subnet. It means that that instance is protected from the internet. No one can access it directly from the internet, but it does have internet access outbound. So that's what an egress-only internet gateway does. Back in the VPC management console, I'm going to go to your VPCs, select my VPC ID, and this is the one that we created today. This is the new custom VPC. And if we go down here, we can see we have an IPv4 CIDR. We don't have an IPv6 CIDR. So let's go to Actions, Edit CIDRs. You can see here that you can add a new IPv4 CIDR. You can't edit the existing one. But what we want to do is add an IPv6 CIDR. So we just choose this option. We've got two options here. Use an Amazon-provided IPv6 CIDR block or another one that we own ourselves. Now we're going to use the Amazon-provided block. And we can leave the network border group as it is and click Select CIDR. So that has been associated to the VPC. And you can see that with an IPv6 CIDR, you've reached the limit of one IPv6 CIDR for your VPC. So you can only have one of these per VPC. Let's click on Close. We now have the IPv6 CIDR block, and we can see it again here, and that's the /56 CIDR block. What we need to do now is go to our subnets, and we want to enable IPv6. I'm going to go to Public 1A first, click on Actions, Edit IPv6 CIDRs, Add IPv6 CIDR, and then this is where we get to specify the numbers which correspond to this individual subnet range. So remember, this is from 00 to FF. These are hexadecimal numbers. So I'm going to start with 00, click on Save, and that public subnet now has an IPv6 CIDR block. Let's now go to Public 1B, click on Actions, Edit, and again, I'm going to do the same thing. This time it's going to be 01, and click on Save. So feel free to do that for all of the other address ranges you have. The other thing I want to do is allow instances to automatically receive an address. So let's go to Modify Auto Assign IP Settings, and now we have this additional option for IPv6 addresses. So let's save that one, and then I'm going to come back and do the same for Public 1B, and then I'm going to repeat that process for all of my subnets, but I'm not going to provide the auto-assigned addresses for my private subnets. So I'm just going to do those for the public ones, but I'm going to give all of my subnets an IPv6 CIDR block. So that's complete. I now have an IPv6 CIDR block for all of my subnets in my new VPC, and I've enabled the auto-assign IP settings for IPv6 for the public subnets only. So let's now go and check our route table. Now, I'm concerned mainly with the public route table associated with this VPC. So let's go and check that one. And we can see we now have the destination of the IPv6 CIDR block with a target of local. Now, what we do need to do is provide a pathway to the internet gateway. So that's ::\0, and then we use internet gateway, choose the internet gateway ID, and then click on Save Routes and click on Close. So now we have the local address. So this is the implicit router is going to be able to route connections to any address within this address space internally. And then the internet gateway will route any connections to IPv6 addresses that are outside of this address range. So that all looks good. Now, the final thing I want to do before I try and do any testing is make sure that I have a security group that has access using the right protocols using IPv6. So let's have a look. Now we've got an outbound rule, and we've got two of them actually. So we've got one for IPv4 and one for IPv6 that allows all traffic. So that's great. So I can try doing a ping request outbound and that should work. What about inbound? Well, we've only got secure shell, but we do have it for both protocols. So that's going to work for SSH connections. But what I want to do is a ping test. And so what I want to be able to do is ping between two EC2 instances in the same security group. I'm going to add a rule, and that rule will allow ICMP IPv6, so that's the Internet Control Message Protocol which ping uses, and it's going to allow it from the actual security group itself. So if I just start typing SG, and we can see the name of the security group up here, and I'm going to select it from this list. So I now have the security group, and click on Save Rules. So that's great. Now I only have one instance at the moment. So let's go over to EC2. And what I'm going to do is for my running instance, I'm going to give it an IPv6 address. So I can go to Networking, Manage IP Addresses, and then click on this box here and assign a new IPv6 address. And you can see it's set to auto assign. So if I just click on Save and Confirm, we should see that this instance now gets a IPv6 address, and we can see that address right here. So that looks good. Now what I want to do is launch a new instance, and this one will go into the 1B subnet. I'm going to use Amazon Linux 2 AMI again, T2 Micro, click on Next. Let's choose our new VPC, the custom VPC. I'm going to choose public 1B for the subnet, one instance. And then if we scroll down, what we should see now is the IPv6 is auto assigned. So let's click on Next, go through to security groups, make sure we put this one in the web access security group, review and launch, and then launch, and we'll launch that instance. And let's just give that a few minutes now to come up. In the meantime, we can go back to the command line and log in to the instance that we already had running. So that's this one here. So I'm going to make sure I have an SSH connection to the public IP address of the existing instance. So I'm on the command line for my machine, and I'm ready to test connectivity. Now what we need is to come back and grab the IPv6 address from the instance we just launched. So I'm going to copy that to my clipboard. And then we come back and we can use a couple of different utilities. We can use ping 6 and then paste in the IPv6 address. Hit enter, and we can see we've got a successful response. Another tool that we can use is ping, and then we put in the address and then -6, and that will do the same thing. It will make sure it uses the IPv6 protocol. So that's it. That's proving that we've got IPv6 working. So I'm very happy with that. We've got IPv6 working. We've finished with these two instances now, so we can terminate both of these instances. Now, of course, you don't pay for VPC, so we don't need to delete anything in our VPC. We've already removed our Elastic IP address from a previous lab and our NAT gateway. So we don't have anything else running at this stage that should be costing us any money. So that's it for this lesson. I hope that was useful, and I'll see you in the next lesson.